Chúng tôi xin mời chủ tịch kiêm tổng giám đốc nhóm các công ty trái phiếu Hồng Kông, Mr. Asin Chan. Và bây giờ thì chúng tôi xin mời tất cả quý vị chúng ta sẽ cùng đến với phiên họp toàn thể ngày hôm nay. Xin trân trọng kính mời.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Park Sung Bin. I'm a professor and dean of the PhD research at the University of Ho Chi Minh City. It's my honor to be here today as a distinguished speaker today. Many thank you for your participation today at the plenary at Vietnam and the Global Economic Outlook. About this time last year, at this time we were facing serious problems in the global economy, including its supply chain, a global economic slowdown, and several uncertainty. Today, when we are here, even though there are many of the pandemic disasters still having issues such as disrupted supply chain and many other uncertainty, but it seems that we have the light at the end of the tunnel. In the meantime, the global economy tend to confirm a soft landing, which is clearly positive for the global economy of everyone. In the plenary today, I would like to welcome our speaker for today's session. May I introduce Mr. Don Lam, Chief Executive Officer and Founding Partner, Vina Capital Vietnam. I would like to welcome Mr. San Bao Wu, Deputy President, State Green Energy Research Institute of China. Professor Zhao Yitao, Director, China Center for Special Economic Zone Research, China. Mr. Yu Jin, Vice President, China Nation Offshore Oil Corporation. Mr. Felix Zhang, co-founder and business group China, and myself. The main topic today is getting insight from this speaker about the global economy. Global economic outlook for 2024, 2025 onward. Specifically, we focus on the current situation and looking into the future global economy. As the global inflation is reduced and energy demand grows, what new venture might be seen in China and in Vietnam to combat climate effect, and which would enhance our growth and boost social well-being? What are the new global endeavor taking place naturally or related by government? What are the short and long-term impediments to sustainable growth? To start with, may I have the insight from Mr. Don Lam, and how can Vietnam, especially from the perspective of being firm, cope with the increase in energy consumption? Particularly, as mentioned in the previous speech by the Deputy Prime Minister, that we are looking to put a new and greener economy. Can you share the entire body, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Wisdom. Regarding to the energy demand and consumption, and what the Deputy Prime Minister mentioned earlier about green energy, I just want to touch on three key points. One is to achieve our clean energy by 2050 net zero, as the Prime Minister highlighted commitment during COP26 in the UK. I think we do three things. One is energy efficiency in terms of usage. Two is moving toward more green and renewable energy. Three is to upgrade our transmission distribution of energy. So I want to touch on the first case where the government already pushed hard for the industry to make it more efficiency usage, where we can save potentially with proper technology in place, maybe 10%, 12% of the energy usage. That's on the industry side. On the consumer side, we are trying to educate consumers to save energy through using more efficient light bulb, more efficient aircon, and so on and so forth. Lastly, the government is now trying to block the leakage. Right now, the transmission line, we lose about 6 or 7% of energy when the transmission takes place. That brings me to the second point, which is upgrading the transmission. Right now, Vietnamese government and EVN is trying to upgrade the transmission line because we need to, especially renewable energy, where most of it is in the south and central Vietnam. We are trying to move energy toward the northern part where we're short of energy. But to do that, you need to upgrade the transmission line. So that's the number two point. Number three point is that under the new master plan, the government is pushing hard to have more renewable energy. At the moment, there are some transitional energy, mostly gas to power, but Vietnam also very strong in solar and wind. If you look at the southern part of Vietnam, it's very sunny, so solar energy is one of the key factor that we can use. And one of the biggest potential in Vietnam at the moment, especially the offshore wind, if you look at the Vietnam coast, it's quite long, and wind resources is very one of the key area that Vietnam can explore. So in terms of renewable, we are looking at mostly solar and wind. Just to give you a quick on Vietnam Capital, we have a $3 billion project called LNG 2 Power in Long An Province, which is about 30 kilometers from Ho Chi Minh City. On renewable, we have a company called SkyX, which produced probably the third largest solar rooftop in Vietnam. And we also partner with EDF of France to do onshore and offshore wind. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Don Lam, regarding that. I especially like when you mentioned that we need to improve and for the transition plan, which is really, really important. So, and we commit, Vietnam commits at the COP 25 that we aim to achieve net zero by 2050. My next question to you is on that, is that from the person in term, can you confirm, cope with that in terms of, even though that in the master plan, there is endeavor to improve and increase the supply of renewable energy, but in fact, then you have that you can predict.
Most companies, especially foreign companies coming to Vietnam, they want to use more green energy, renewable energy. But there's a lot of difficulty, mainly because you know, the EPA or the Record Purchase Agreement rules is not clear yet. And one of the key issues at the moment, how to get green energy to the multinational company. So in Vietnam today, there's a number of new regulations that is in draft, hopefully coming out soon, make it easier for company to use their own and produce their own renewable energy either through a direct PPA or more easier rule on the solar rooftop. So that's coming, the regulation is coming, and that's a big potential area for Chinese company to invest if you are here.
Thank you, Don. My next question to Mr. Chan Bao Guo, Deputy President, State Green Energy Research Institute, to follow up on that. What is the development trend of global energy and power transformation globally and in China? Can you share your view on this, please?
Thank you. 非常高兴能来教育。今天我想就全球的这个经济增长和中国、越南的经济增长，包括能源转型，观点的交流分享。 确实现在全球经济进入了一个非常复杂多变的一个阶段，这个气候转型、气候变化压力逐渐增大，世界各国都在加快能源转型的步伐，能源转型向绿色化、低碳化步伐迈进。中国在全球能源转型中发挥了重要的作用，因为在整个的过去的三年，世界的疫情发生以后，对经济造成了很大的波动。中国在这个恢复疫情的恢复经济的增长方面，做了大量的卓有成效的工作。要通过能源转型，也有力的促进了经济的增长，为世界的经济的增长和能源转型做出了中国的贡献。2023年，中国的经济增长5.2%的增长，跟越南可能会略低一点，但都基本上都保持了5%以上的增长。这是在整个的世界经济体里面还是增长比较快的，还在前列。同时，中国的经济增长的5.2%的增长，这个增量相当于6万亿人民币，也是相当于欧洲的一个国家的经济总量。所以中国的经济的发展对世界的经济的发展做出了一个重要贡献，贡献率应该是在30%左右这么一个情况。那么对于中国的能源转型，跟全球的气候变化紧密相关。中国国家主席在习近平同志在2020年提出了我们的2030-2060双碳目标，争取在2030年实现碳达峰，在2060年实现碳中和。这我也注意到，越南我们也提出了双碳目标，在2050年提出了实现碳中和。这是对中越两国来讲都带来了很多的压力和挑战，但是呢，中国在这个能源转型里面已经下定了决心，必须要加快能源转型。能源转型不是别人让我们做，是我们自己要做。那么能源转型当然也面临着很多的困难挑战，但同时也面临着机遇。就像刚才那个陈副总理说到的，我也非常赞成。这个世界经济复杂多变，唯有我们自己把自己做好，我们才能为世界做出更大的贡献。那么这些年中国在能源转型方面，加大可再生能源的投资力度，可再生能源快速发展。2023年的新能源的装机，风电、光伏装机接近3亿箱，那么这个规模也是非常，是为世界新能源的一个增量贡献了大部分增量，50%以上。这也为世界经济增长、中国的经济增长都发挥了重要作用。现在中国的风电、光伏、电池还有电动汽车都成为拉动中国经济增长也新的动力，也成为我们中国对外贸易的新三样。这个新三样就是新能源汽车、锂电池和光伏。那么去年2023年，我们的对外贸易超过了1万亿人民币，占整个中国的出口的比重达到了4.5%，对外贸出口的贡献率拉动率超过1%，这是紧紧的通过这新三样，包括还有产业链、供应链的拉动经济增长，那更是非常明显。所以我说呢，这个世界经济遭遇了 困难的过程，但是能源转型又给我们带来了新的机遇。好，我先分享这个。
Thank you very much for joining us. I think that the data in the China energy and according to data from the International Energy Agency, in 2023, China electricity demand rose by 6.4%, driven by the services and industrial sector, with the country with growth expected to slow and become less reliant on heavy industry. So the electricity demand is expected to ease to 5.1% in 4.9% in 2025 and 4.7% in 2026. Can you, Mr. Zhu Jin, my friend, National China Offshore Oil Corporation, elaborate on this? Back on the Chinese economy, please.
化石是啊，对于我们的能源能够支持，尤其是中国的经济，以我们中国的这个经济数据来看，从2020年到2024年，中国的经济的年增长，包括 GDP 的增长，这个数据上，虽然说我们的这个用电的数据主要。这个刚才主持人所说的，在未来这个2024、2025会增长，但是增幅呢也更少，会有几个因素所决定的这么一个情况。一个呢，中国的经济的增长快速的增长，而且呢，这个疫情后的工作恢复，2024年我认为中国经济增长的速度还会持续在2023年增长的快速。那么这来说，我们的用电还会有很好的，尤其是在我们的特斯拉厂的新工制造，在我们的新能源的发展，尤其是新能源汽车的这个思路上面，在移动式的地位，这个等方面啊，更多的需求，这些的新增长的需求，抵消我们一些传统产业在升级中淘汰之后产能中的降低的那个。第二点，我们的这个用能呢，应从过去传统的靠用大量的这个用电的量来促进增长，往下呢，用我们叫量的稳定的增长与质的有效的提升，相结合的这个发展态势。所以说，在中国的在传统产业的转型升级中，会有大量淘汰低效的。会对我们一些传统产业升级改造，现在用能的效率上也很有效的提升，这是我们啊中国的高产发展往前走必须要进行的。
Thank you very much. I would like to shift attention a bit to the other aspects of global economic outlook on the supply chain. Even though that recent report show that the last few years, disrupted supply chain has been slowly recovering, even though the cost is quite high. And I would like to shift to Professor Cao Yi Cao for your comment on this, and can you shift some insight about it?
首先感谢郑明堂主任方的邀请，能出席会议今次会议呢是我的荣幸。刚刚各位对充分专业的领域在谈到关于可持续发展和清洁能源的问题，
在谈到关于可持续发展和清洁能源的问题。我呢想从另一个角度来谈一下 关于可持续发展的问题。我们知道中国和越南都是前社会主义国家，两个国家都相继进行了改革开放和革新开放。中国的越南长几年是从1978年开始的，越南是1986年开始的。但是我们看到经过20多年的发展，越南社会发生巨大变化，今天的越南已经成为全球资本投资的热点，能取得这样大的成就，跟越共的改革革新的政策和理念是分不开的。那么我们在谈到可持续发展和绿色能源呢，我们还要从另一个角度来思考问题，那就是可持续发展本身还包括一个国家占优势和主导地位的生产要素是否能够一直保持可持续发展的这样的优势。我很赞同刚刚李副总理讲话当中提到的一个观点，他说越南不是靠劳动力价格和土地价格低廉来吸引资本，而是靠它的绿色环保科技数字经济的发展呢来吸引资本。从这个角度考虑问题，应该讲是非常聪明和明智的。我们知道越南现在的越南的发展来看呢，越南已经是人口破亿了，已经是世界15个人口超过1亿的国家之一。那么随着人口增长和经济的发展，土地的使用将越来越多，土地是相对稳定固定的，不会很难再生产出来，除非你填海造田。那么从这个意义上来讲呢，对土地的有规划的可持续使用，使越南能够保持经济长期低成本、相对低成本发展很重要的一个关键的问题。我们知道中国的改革开放虽然取得了巨大的成就，但是在中国改革开放的进程当中也有一些经验教训，比如土地资源的过度消耗使用，以至于现在大城市土地价格上涨，土地价格上涨，房地产价格上涨，人们生活的成本增加。那么这是一个要十几年才能逐渐展现出的问题。那么越南政府能够提早在改革开放刚起步的时候就能够考虑到对土地的合理使用，这是非常重要的。另外呢，我们知道中国的企业纷纷到越南来，看着国外的企业也纷纷落户越南，主要看重越南的劳动力价格低廉。越南是一个年轻的人口年轻化的城市，这个国家越南的平均年龄在32.7岁，深圳现在的平均年龄在32.7岁，深圳的平均年龄在32.5岁。那么这都是一个年轻的城市，同时越南有超过5000万的就是真正的劳动人口，这是越南的一个非常大的优势。相对当时越南劳动力价格呢，也不是相对低廉的。但是随着经济的发展，GDP 水平的提高和人均 GDP 水平是一定要提高的，劳动力价格是一定要上涨的。那么从这个意义上来讲，可以说一个国家，任何一个国家都没有永远吃不完的劳动力红利。那么我预判一下，越南的以按照越南目前的经济发展水平，越南的劳动力红利还得是20年。20年以后，由于种种因素，劳动力红利就可以逐渐消失。差不多中国也是按照这个轨迹走的。那么劳动力红利消失的两大原因，一个就是刚刚我讲了经济发展以后呢，劳动力价格是一定要提升的。如果人们的收入水平 不能够随着经济发展的速度而一同提升的，就会带来社会问题。那么另一个方面呢，一般的来讲，一个国家的人口出生率要在保持在 2.1 左右的水平，才能够做到这个国家的代际的更替，就是能够不断的一代一代的劳动力产生。目前的越南呢，随着经济的发展，随着成为一亿人口的大国，但是出生率在下降，出生率现在已经在 2.1.9 这样的一个程度。那么这样的那个 1.9 这样的一个出生率呢，意味着长期下去，一个国家人口将走，数量将走到下坡。那么如果不及时采取一些相关的政策，像比如鼓励多生，鼓励为新生儿和儿童的成长，政府支付一些成本，降低其生活养育，降低家庭养育的费用的话呢，那么人口出生率下降必然带来一个国家劳动力红利的减弱。那么这是从这两点来讲呢，就是越南两大优势，就是钥匙优势，土地和人口，这是越南现在走在经济高速发展的有利条件，也是越南必须以更合理科学的有远见的政策来保持这个红利能够一直存在下去的一个很重要的课题。那么另外想说一个比我们今天讨论题稍微普遍一点的相偏一点的问题，那就是我们知道中越之间的贸易是具有相当大的可能性，而且就目前来看，越南是中国进口的第一大国，那么也是出口目的地的第二大国，两国的贸易的往来应该讲既有坚定的政治基础，政治是经济的最高体现，两国领导人的互动是两国经济经贸往来的一个重要的前提。那么同时呢，两国之间贸易的往来也是具有经济上的这个必然性，这个经济上的必然性就表现为中国比越南先发展，现在已经从工业化的初期开始进入了相对高的发展阶段，越南开始工业化起，那么中国向越南的资本输出在很大程度上它具有资本或者说产业梯度转移的这样的含义。那么这种产业的梯度转移对中国来讲是一些过剩的资本产能的输出，对越南来讲在承继了中国转移过来的产业的同时，在进口的过程当中实现进口学习效应，这种进口学习效应也是中国改革开放40多年来一直所走的路。中国改革开放初期就是从进口产品然后走向模仿，由模仿走向中国中国制造，慢慢在进口中学习，所以越南也可以走进口中学习这样的一个提升产业的路径。另外呢，我也关注到了越南在改革开放的进程当中加大了与国的世界市场的融合，比如 RCEP 和 CPTPP 的相继的这个签署，使越南的市场更加广阔了，越南的贸易伙伴不仅仅是中国，还有更广阔的领域和更多的国家，这在客观上会减少与中国的这种贸易的总额。比如根据 CPTPP 的规定，原产地原则，棉制品的原产地原则，它是从棉纱开始，棉纱从哪里进口的，那么按照 CPTPP 的规定，这个越南原来从中国进口的棉纱就要下降，要改成从CPTPP 成员国来进口棉纱。那么这一过程呢，应该讲对中国的棉纱出口是有些影响的，但是从另一个意义上来讲，它也会促进中国改变或者提升优化与越南的产品贸易， 出口的贸易结构。所以在经济全球化的今天，对任何一个国家市场的扩大、交易伙伴的增加都不是一个坏事。一个国家之间的贸易往来不仅仅在于贸易的数量彼此的依赖，还更在于贸易往来过程中能够促进本国产业的提升，能够促进贸易结构的改变。所以贸易往来的过程实际上也是一个促进双方产业提升的过程。所以从这个意义上来讲，越南与中国贸易量的下降也并不是坏事，它会促进与中国产业结构的优化和进行调整。最后呢，我想说一句话，我们知道繁荣的国家，应该讲是强大的国家与繁荣的市场是我们所追求的。那么它建立第一个繁荣市场和强大的国家的前提就是一个法治。
Talking a little bit on the global economy, so actually what I'd like to do is before I go into the government stimulations, I want to talk about two major economic trend globally last 30 years. We talk about economic reformsin China ever since the early 1980s. And the results of that is very clear. Right? China's GDP actually increased over 30, 40 times. And now it's about $18-19 trillion in 2024, and which is about 16-17% global economy. And this is massive. And basically you are increasing from 1-2% to 16-17%. So that's one major trend everyone knows. And I think the second major trend I want to speak of is people often ignore, and I think that's very, very important because that's also implied what China has to do going forward. And in the OECD countries, if we use OECD countries as a proxy for the developed countries, and there's about 40 countries, and back in 1989, 1990, and economic speaking, American economy is one half of other developed countries. Today, in 2024, American economy is pretty much the rest of developed countries combined and more. And this is very important, right? I mean, give you one number here. In 1990, Germany and Japan's economy combined GDP is the same as the United States. 2 trillion plus 4 trillion and US is 6 trillion. Today, US is about 30 trillion. Germany is about 4 and Japan is about 4. Germany and Japan combined is 8 trillion. It's actually only one quarter of the American economy. So the implication of that is very important. It's why what's happening in the global economy. S&P 500 this year, 30% S&P 500 market cap is digital economy. It's the so-called Magnificent Seven, which is from Google's Apple's to Nvidia. And Europe has none. Japan pretty much has none. So we talk about global economy, we have to talk about innovations, new economy, new industries, and how do we drive the economy going forward. Government economic policy stimulations. What do we have in the United States? 2 years ago, Biden's government actually has introduced Inflation Reduction Act, IRA. The idea of the Inflation Reduction Act is to stimulate key economies, as many of the colleagues at the platform here, which mentioned energy transition, semiconductors, and robotics, artificial intelligence, and the impact of that is over $1 trillion. Well, the dollar amount is $1 trillion, as the impact of that is actually much bigger. This year, Europe has announced Green Deal. The Green Deal actually has to do with the energy transition as well, regarding the climate change issues. China's policy is very clear, as most of you know very well, focusing on EVs,
EV batteries, energy transitions, advanced manufacturing, artificial intelligence, semiconductors, robotics, and I think this is actually quite comparable, US, China, and Europe. But how can China compete in the long-term sustainable? And I think really we need to look at what's happening in the world at the moment. And so we can actually get out of this, I think some colleagues mentioned about middle-income trap. How do we get out of the middle-income trap? And really, I think the innovations and private enterprise and the colleagues mentioned about legally based and regulations, and all of this is very important. And I also want to mention about financial markets. Financial markets are very important. Well, we are actually having, in China we're reducing interest rate because we have a deflationary environment. And so the interest rate is dropping. And in some other countries we are facing inflationary issues like the United States. And there's abundant liquidity in the markets. That's why commodity price, gold, bitcoins, all the prices are going up. And how do we actually manage that? And the real interest rate globally is very low and almost neutral. And can we actually manage that and have our financial markets, which is actually very important for the global economy going forward, and also for China. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Bali, for your views on the global economy and the role of the, China and Vietnam, in particular in that perspective. And even though that we are recovering, the economy is recovering, but there are still some problems in both Vietnam and China regarding the both high debt level and the other impact in the disruption of the supply chain. I would like to ask Mr. Don Lam regarding the increasing role of China in the global economy in 2024-2025. Please.
Thank you. I probably cannot comment too much on the Chinese economy, but I can perhaps talk about the China economy and Vietnam somehow interlinked. You know, based on the 2022 and early 2023 is one of the first year where both China and Vietnam export actually dropped compared to prior year since the financial crisis. And that's one of the reasons is the post-COVID, there's a lot of inventory built up in the US and Europe, and so they're trying to deleverage the inventory level. And the good news is, toward the end of 2023 last year and now this year, export from both countries is actually increasing. And so that's looking good for the economy overall. I do recognize that there's a need for China and Vietnam to cooperate because a lot of the supply chain and the ecosystem between the two countries is quite interrelated. As Vietnam import a lot of the material and semi-finished good into Vietnam and finalize, finish it, and export. So I do see 2024 and 25 in a much better spot. I'm hoping that for Vietnam, for example, we're looking at to grow about 6 to 6.5% GDP this year, and perhaps also next year. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Don. I have a question to follow up Don's speech Mr. San Bao Hua, and what area that Vietnam and China can cooperate, can co-create value in the future? Mr. San Bao Hua.
昨天呢，跟那个咱们平阳这个董事长啊，咱们的平阳市嘛，这个政府有关的交流，发现平阳现在的正处于一个工业化、城市化快速推进的一个阶段。中国应该说也走过了一个工业化和城镇化快速推进的这么一个阶段。中国是在2000年、2000年之后开始的。 加入世界贸易组织之后，那么现在越南来讲，也是正处于这么一个过程。在这过程中，中国有很多的经验可以借鉴，但是也有很多的教训、弯路，需要参考。我想，这个中越两国之间的这种道路很相似、很接近。中国的经验，包括中国的教训，我觉得对越南来讲、发展来讲，都会是有益的参考。不仅仅是我们的经验我们可以参考，我觉得教训我们的越南可能更值得参考。你比如说我们的在工业化、城市化快速推进的时候，我们的能源电力需求快速增长，但是也带来了缺电，带来了损失，对经济社会发展都带来了很大的制约。那么在我们的越南快速发展的过程中，我注意到我们的过去20年经济的发展，包括能源电力需求都保持很快的增长。我也注意到我们的越南可能也有出现这个电力短缺的情况。我想说的就是说，在未来在越南工业化、城镇化快速推进的过程中，要高度的重视电力安全。在中国我们习总书记明确要提出来，我要保证能源安全。所以对于越南来讲，保证能源的安全，保证越南的能源绿色低碳转型、加快转型，这对越南来讲也是一个非常重大的课题。那么中国由此在进行双碳战略部署的时候，提出来四个统筹，我觉得这个四个统筹越南也可以参考。第一个是发展和减排。发展，我们要发展，我们还是发展中国家，中国和越南都一样。中国人均 GDP 刚刚达到1.27万美元，当然越南还在进一步加快追赶。我们都是发展中国家，我们都需要发展，大力发展。那么我们需要保证能源安全。那么能源安全，我们不能用化石能源来满足，我们必须要用绿色的能源来满足。所以我们既要发展，又要减排。所以这个统筹，所以要考虑好。这个统筹不是说我要发展，我就不要传统的化石，我们传统的化石里面还要发挥重要的作用，但是一定要更好的发挥我们绿色的能源的作用。第二个统筹近期和远期，我们中越两国都是制定了长远目标。我们这个也有这个5年规划。我也注意到我们越南也去年也公布了一个越南第8个10年规划，对未来能源的发展，尤其是新能源的发展，都提出了明确的目标。但是在这个目标之间短期和长期目标之间如何做到衔接、有序的过渡，也是一个难题。另外一个统筹是我们的整体格局。那对中国来讲这个很多的地区东中西部特点不一样，那么对越南来讲，可能北部和南部也不一样。北部的水电资源丰富，南部的风光资源丰富，那么我们这个南部和北部也可以进行很好的统筹。另外一个就是统筹，就是政府和市场。刚才那个咱们陶女士讲的，我觉得这个市场繁荣市场，这是一个非常重要的因素。我们现在中国也在要突出统筹政府和市场，有为政府和有效市场。昨天我听到我们这个平壤的这个同志讲到我们的政府做了很好的规划， 我想说呢，咱们的政府一定要有为，也不能越位，该让市场解决的一定要用市场的手段来解决。中国新能源发展这么快，既有政府的作用，也有市场的作用。刚开始我们鼓励新能源发展，给予财政补贴，新能源的发展突飞猛进，技术不断的迭代，成本不断的下降。现在我们的新能源的成本已经下降到跟火电的成本接近或者更低，具备了从过去的政府补贴到市场竞争的一个平稳过渡。这个方面我觉得政府的作用和市场的作用同样都非常重要。通过这几个方面就是我分享的这个经验这个案例，就说明了在我们的经济能源转型过程中都会面临很多的问题和挑战。我们能不能去克服应对这些挑战？如果应对好了，那么我们就会怎么样，给一个更加美好的未来。如果您应对不好，就会带来各种各样的问题。前几年中国呢也会出现了一些缺电的情况，这个电力紧张，煤价格飙升，这个新能源因为它是波动的，它靠天吃饭，所以不能解决所有问题。所以我们现在中央也提出来了，我们要先立后破，这个传统能源要发挥作用，关键是新能源要立得起来。你立不起来，你就不能把过去的传统能源给破掉。但是怎么统筹先立后破，这也是一个科学问题。我就分享这些，谢谢。
Thank you, Mr. Sanbagua, regarding your sharing on the role of government in coping with the current issue like pollution.Energy demand. And so I think that to follow up, I would like to invite Mr. Junyi. Can you share a vision from your perspective of the cooperation, right, offshore oil cooperation in China? What can the government do further to deal with the issue? For example, Mr. Shan Wang was mentioned, the pollution increase.Energy demand, balance between the history and modern.
Okay, 谢谢主持人。我来自中国海油，中国三省之一。主要我们是传统的油气勘探开发。那么新阶段呢，我们也是在油气、电氢，包括从产供到用多方面呢，在推进我们企业的。但是我们中国的。能源的意义，从这个由传统的化石向新能源的转换的过程，让我们也发现中国在新能源发展也是存在的阶段性的不少问题，尤其是我们现在的新能源的装机容量，去年呢达到4.5亿千瓦，这4.5亿千瓦。那么我们的去年的电的用电消费呢，达到三万一千瓦时，在这种条件下，实际上大家发现中国政策有些变化。对于这个，实际上目前来看，我们的电光伏风电起光起温的这个问题非常严重。这主要就因为我们当装了这么大规模的这个新能源以后，实际上我们的这个调频配套的电源的稳定、配套的通道的建设时等等一些问题。同时我们现在看到中国的新能源发展中用一些分散式的各自建设的储能的系统的建设。
Lem加油红外的网络 Lem 加油的网络。
小散的建设，那是一种低效的无效的投资。这就给我们尤其
你们
熬
着的那感觉到了那感觉到了。
是新能源建设不
同。那太红高了熬着了。这个更累了没有我就这个就不用空上我。
一个环境，以传统带新，新旧结合，伴侣式发展，它是我们目前的在这个全球能源转型的探索阶段的一个重要的渠道。所 说这块呢，我们这个中国海油呢，我们也想下步啊，跟这个越南会计师公司要进行深入的交流。像我们现在海油的发展的这个新能源，我们更多聚焦海上分店、深远海的分店，因为现在来说，中国的现在的陆地的分店发电小时数呢，也就是1000小时每年，这个近海的分店也就是2000小时。我们深远海总是3000到4000，它的能源的密度、规模性、对土地占有的累积的影响要小得多。所以说，为了我们在依托海洋石油工程的工程技术进行深海开发中，我们也进一步想探索跟越南石油公司啊，在这个北部湾或者我们叫东湾的那个大的湾区上建设，在13万平方公里的一个区域内。实际上我们可以共享技术，共同探索，在海洋的这个能源通道建设上面，把我们的一些探索的经验，能否在这个越南的能源新通道建设上面，发挥我们两家的技术一些合作的可能性。因为这块我们现在是在中国的深远海，在国家发改委的策划下，我们正在谋划一些更大规模通道性的这些这个分店的安排。大家知道中国的能源是大部分是从北部的内蒙区、西部的于是分店光伏这些能源新建的区域，长距离的道调用成本极高。在我们的海洋的这个深远海离岸有100公里左右，我们也就意味着我们如果把海深海的那个开发起来，通道就100公里的建设，就可以实现我们沿海的这些区域呢，缺电区域不需要长距离调用西北的内陆区域的电力，这种啊就给我们形成了新的这个区域的差异化互补的优势。而且我们在深海的深远海的分电发展中，100公里通道上岸以后，我们可以用我们天然气发电作为呢我们的新能源的它的调频稳定的通道的设计，因为它中气电具有调频快、稳定性好、规模大、投资省等等优势，这种对我们未来来看呢，是中国的新能源发展会是一个进一步在历史的经验总结、教学的反思中，会进一步的优化我们的新能源布局、产业结构的发展。在这方面呢，中国的国家能源局将会出台相关的政策，会降低这种无效投资带来的影响。谢谢。
Thank you very much, Chujin. It seems that all speakers today unanimously agree that the importance of a clean environment to combat with climate change, the important role of using the renewable energy. The last question I would like to ask the two non-energy background, that Mr. Felix Yang and Mr. Don Lam. When I met Felix in the speaker room, he asked me whether I am bullish or bearish about the global economy. I think that I will have this question to ask him again about it. Felix, Don, please, Felix.
Okay, well, thanks. I think in the global economy, including Chinese economy, we have a lot of short-term and long-term challenges. And if you look at short-term, we are actually facing, in China, property sector. And if you look at the debt, especially the local debt, and we look at a lot of imbalances in terms of consumption. We have a very high unemployment rate for the youth, right? Over 20%. And actually, more than that, the equity market is a little bit stabilized. But what I have seen is the innovations and startups and entrepreneurship in China now is facing a lot of challenges in terms of financing. Venture capital funds are increasingly become more difficult investing startups. Now today I want to emphasize innovations and startups. It's extremely important. It's only 15 years ago we were a startup. right? And how do we actually get financing? How do we actually work in the financial markets and the economic markets and become one of the leading companies? And those are very key short-term challenges. And also geopolitics, right? And there's all sorts of wars going on, as you saw what happened last night. And those geopolitical issues is increasingly have a huge impact on economic policies. There is China Plus One, which Vietnam is benefiting. There's nearshoring, which Mexico is benefiting. With onshoring, which American companies, European companies, Japanese companies themselves are benefiting. So those are all the key short-term challenges. What are the long-term challenges? My colleagues talk about demographics. China's demographics is having some serious, serious issues. And every year our population is declining. But more than that, it is not about population declining. Actually, our working population is declining even faster. Which means, and how do we actually look at dependency ratios, pensions, who's paying tax to pay for it? Right? Debt issues. America have debt issues, national debt last year 8%, this year 8% as well. And China have debt issues, especially local debts. And it's also long-term, really seriously long-term issues. And energy transition and climate change issues is really about how do we actually make a sustainable environment for this planet? And how do we have equality? Equality in terms of between the nations, equality between all the different people. And all those long-term challenges need to be addressed. And in my view, it is very important, in addition to the government policies, how do we actually encourage innovations and creating an environment for enterprise to thrive? And I think that's very, very, very important. And last but not the least, I really think that globally, we have a lot of, well, in my view, it's misunderstandings. And many times I find that we're not speaking on the same terms. That's why I find this forum is very important. But how do we actually improve that? It's also a long-term sustainable. It's how do we actually improve long-term global communications, global understandings. And only by that, our political policies and economic policies can be sustainable for the long term. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. I mean, most of the topic already covered pretty much by Felix, but I just want to share some of our personal view is for global economy in 2024 and 2025, we think there's a lot of challenges, especially the uncertainty around what's happening in the Middle East and Europe with the war. So the consumer confidence are not there. Everyone is surfing the protected mode because they don't know what's happening the next 12 months or the next 24 months. On top of that, you have the US election coming up in November, so that's additional uncertainty. So globally, I think a lot of people are just on the defensive and trying to not invest more, but more on the saving and defensive. But from a Vietnam perspective, as I said earlier, we still believe that our economy continue to grow about 6.5%, mainly through because of the FDI manufacturing that's moving into Vietnam and the exporting sector recovering. So I think Vietnam's doing fine, but globally, there's a lot of challenges. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tom. In the interest of time, we can have one or two quick questions from the audience, from the floor. Any question, please? If not, then I think that I can conclude today's session. Thank you very much, distinguished speaker, for sharing your views on the energy demand and the way toward a greener environment and your point of view on the global economic outlook. I share with you that there are several uncertainties going ahead, but with Vietnam and China, with the collaborate together and with the given the situation, that I believe that there will be light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you.